My talk is called Actions We Can Take Now. Just to let everyone know that this could be basically modified across all councils in terms of the document. But I come with a lens from a peripheral vascular disease council member and someone who serves a predominantly underserved population here in rural South America. So this should serve as a springboard for changes that we can be implemented across the board to bridge the gap in disparities. I have no disclosures for this talk. So here are the mega trends that are impacting the cardiovascular field. We have an aging and growing population, as stated earlier. We have the prevalence of chronic diseases, aging population, diabetes in play, diabetes and obesity, changes in terms of how we test and we perform procedures. We're now a value-based care population medical committee. We have an aging cardiology healthcare workforce, projected shortages in terms of primary care specialists, but also we're now specialty deserts. And we have underrepresentation of minorities across the cardiovascular field with a leaky pipeline. And then social determinants of health, sprinkle of systemic inequities, and implicit biases. All these are in play when it comes to actions. So for instance, PAD is one of the most chronic, deadly, debilitating, costly of all cardiovascular diseases, but least known from a patient-provider community standpoint. And you can see that across the board. However, what we have failed to do is become disruptive in terms of how we raise awareness. And I think as a specialty, we need to think outside the box in terms of rather than talking to each other within society or intra communications within different societal councils, propose that we increase not only general public awareness disparities in the healthcare platform from national health campaigns, similar to what our oncological partners have done. Not only talk to our fellow members within our societies, but maybe celebrity messaging, social media coalition building across all multidisciplinary teams. And these campaigns need to basically be rich in terms of culturally and linguistically, and they need to meet these patients where they are on a community level and utilize our prime time slots in all our meetings or conferences to highlight disparities in multidisciplinary presentations. Today's session serves as an example, but I think we need to do more of this on the big stage, which some of us are trying to do right now. What about the risk factors, as Dr. Alton mentioned? Undertreatment of PAD and CLI. As you all know, statins, antiplatelets, antihypertensives, and oral hypoglycemics are definitely not prescribed. Supervised exercise testing, you know, one of the pillars now, only 2%. Smoking cessation counseling. So the risk factors are undertreated in these communities. And so what we need to do is to make sure that in all forms of our treatment algorithms, that we remember that. And as stated, what about this whole amputation lottery, which is basically the fact that most of these patients are not giving a fighter's chance. They do not have access to even angiograms that we know decrease the odds of an amputation by 90%. So it's not only who you are, or where you are, but it's your race, ethnicity, your age, your sex, the hospital, your site of service, but also your insurance status. Are you underinsured, uninsured, or do you have commercial insurance? That also plays a role. And it's not only in rural areas, but as stated in the recent article by our colleagues in Pennsylvania, if you look at urban cities, metropolitan areas, all the big cities that has access to all multidisciplinary teammates that are involved in CLI or CLTI care, there's still maldistribution of care. And so it's the low socioeconomic status and the racial and ethnic minorities that suffer disproportionately. And what's the answer? Well, let's look at the bedrock to which societies need to modify their care delivery models and focus research and disseminate equal quality care. The answer is social determinants of health. Given that diabetes, hypertension, heart disease are preventable, treatable, and have been targeted public health policy pillars for a long time, we have failed to bridge the gap in over 20 years when it comes to social determinants of health and racial health disparities. In spite of all the advancements that we've made in our space, from pharmaceutical, from device, and research, there's still gaps. And so what we need to do is to try and improve the life expectancy of these patients. And as we recently published in this journal article by Dr. He and colleagues, social determinants of health is the moderator of cardiovascular factors in Black patients. We're seeing a rise in BMI and A1Cs, but we're also seeing a decrease in cigarette smoking and total cholesterol. If you were to break that down, that prevalence by race and ethnicity, those are our white patients who have the decrease in cigarette smoking and total cholesterol, and unfortunately, young minorities who have a high rise in the diabetes epidemic. And so there's been this long generational mistrust. Some people call it a bias, implicit bias, and explicit bias. I call it statistical discrimination, in which that a physician and patient's preconceived notion of what the course of treatment should be for someone who walks into a room is based on basically that patient's likely candidacy for treatment and based on past course of treatment to patients who share similar characteristics, and race is a factor. So when it comes to subjectivity, which medicine becomes at some point, bias is in play, and we need to address that. So what do I propose? We need to not only improve access to quality care in areas lacking specialties or resources, but we need to develop regional expertise when it comes to team building and delivery of care. We need to address the ever-elusive social determinants of health into all our algorithms and sustainable community-based strategies that demonstrate effectiveness. We need to support and incentivize physicians and non-physicians to adequately address the relationship between patient demographics, their risk factors, lifestyle medications, and patient education. And we need QA and QI initiatives and outcomes with respect to race. We also have to mandate some kind of public reporting when it comes to not only amputation rates, but also other cardiovascular disparate rates, and maybe utilize our EMRs to offer free QA and QI tools to promote standardized care and documentation for these results. Implicit bias training should occur in all our labs, and we need to promote a diverse cardiovascular health force, which reflects and engenders a care-seeking behavior where patients can seek out these providers throughout the continuum of their care, but also across all appointments and committees in our societies. There should be some concordance. We need to identify hospitals that have these persistent institutional gaps in care and then expand scholarships and loan forgiveness for patients and specialists who are coming to these specialty deserts and target the pipeline with an emphasis of recruitment and retention of minorities. What about the roots of unnecessary amputations when it comes to the lack of early screening? Well, we need to address the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force recommendation, which basically has stated that there are basically no, there's no evidence in terms of the impact of asymptomatic screening in the general population. Well, that's not what we seek. We seek screening in the at-risk or high-risk population that Dr. Alton has recommended in her talk, right? Patients who are over a certain age, so the aging population, diabetics, racial and ethnic minorities, and those patients who have low socioeconomic statuses. Well, they note that their statement could discourage and perpetuate disparities in treatment and outcomes. However, the evidence of screening these groups is currently lacking, and we need to have future research to include more diverse populations and report on their outcomes. However, when you look at all clinical trials to date, we have failed to include that population that the USPSTF seeks. When it comes to women, when it comes to African American, Hispanics, Native Americans, and chronic kidney disease patients can be included in this. Who are what? These are the high-risk patients for an amputation, particularly when you look at CLI in African American populations. It's your diabetes population, which is the number one predictor for CKD, and also hypertensive patients, more prevalent in the African American population than in white populations. And so it's not only immersing yourself in all forms when it comes to community engagement, but making sure that we need to inform to transform. We need to do a better job of getting out of our comfort zones and going to these communities and explaining what these gaps are and engendering and facilitating them to come and seek care. So we propose not only having a true prevalence of your cardiovascular disease state by race, sex, but also what are the practices for disparities and care and outcomes? And what are your local amputation rates, for instance, by race and sex? And what are your screening and voluntary programs that are in place to help specifically address these high-risk populations? What are the policies to recruit and increase underrepresentation and disadvantaged students in sciences and research? And then what are we doing from a medical school curriculum to also include not only topics like more PAD, but also health disparate education and social determinants of health? Close to the end here, allyship matters. Allyship matters. We need to become allies in this. We're not only with our interventional radiology colleagues, but also our vascular surgeons. We need to make sure that we partner with other vascular societies and other local communities and faith-based, like we did with the barbershop initiative, to promote health-driven initiatives within the marginalized communities. We also need to have cross-training of MD team members during fellowship training. We shouldn't wait till we become attendings. We need to do this on all levels, but also attend professional development courses and lectures on healthcare disparities, and those designed towards team building and enhanced CLTI team development. Lastly, advocacy. As Martin Luther King said, morality cannot be legislated, but behavior can be regulated, and judicial decrees may not change people's hearts, but the goal is to restrain the heartless. So advocacy matters when it comes to utilizing our megaphone. Across all societies, we need to get comfortable going out and taking our patients to the halls of Congress to lobby for our patients in terms of their treatments and outcomes. And an example here is the Amputation Reduction and Compassion ARC Act, which SCAI is gladly supporting, with main provisions not only to help fund and establish and coordinate a PAD educational program through HHS, but to establish coverage for PAD screening tests for those who are high risk without cost sharing, irrespective of their socioeconomic status. And also to entertain the fact that non-emergent amputation should not occur without some proper form of anatomical testing done prior to their amputation, but also requiring the development of quality measures through HHS to reduce amputation relating to PAD, with exceptions to these provisions per SVS guidelines. Again, using our allies and their guidelines in helping craft the legislation. And so we're not only establishing congressional awareness through this process, but also we're developing a national task force called PAD Task Force to address healthcare disparities across the spectrum. So I encourage everyone to not only support the ARC Act, but work with your congressional and other stakeholders on fundamental physician fee schedule reform to provide long-term stability so that we have the ability to be able to speak across all spectrums, whether you're in a hospital setting or outpatient setting. And lastly, it's just to read on what your colleagues are doing from our standpoint here. This is the Black amputation epidemic. There is a Native American amputation epidemic. There is a Hispanic amputation epidemic. There's a female amputation epidemic. It must stop. Thank you very much for your time.